You've seen unofficial modified versions of Windows XP and newer, but what about Windows 98? This is the Windows 98 unattended boot CD, put together by someone called Soporific in February 2008. It is based on Windows 98 second edition from 1999, so not exactly 10 years later, but never mind. This CD includes several drivers and updates. Keep in mind, back in the late 2000s, Windows 98 was considered awfully outdated and obsolete, and not an interesting retro vintage OS that even people born after this 10th anniversary version want to try. Back then, anyone who wanted Windows and wasn't wowed by Vista would have XP. I'm running this OS on this Dell Optiplex 170L from around 2004 or 2005. It's quite a bit newer than Windows 98, but it has drivers for most components, and it's a low-end model where Windows XP doesn't run super well, especially today. So let's try 98, which should not struggle at all on this hardware. And now let's begin the installation. Of course, the CD is bootable. We get this menu with a lot of options. Normally, you start with partitioning the drive. And here it recommends using a tool called GDisk instead of the typical Microsoft FDisk, which I've already used to create a partition. So now I'll just switch to DOS to format it. Let's check out the color schemes that are available here. 6 looks like the Slackware Linux installer, but let's pretend we're HackerMan here. So I'll choose the color scheme number 7. Here's the option menu. You can also configure these settings after installation, but I wanted to show it anyway. For keyboard, I'll use US International. For region, I'll do US so it doesn't show time and date in another language. For time zones, I'll choose the one I'm currently in. And then you can change the computer name, work group, and the name and organization that shows in system properties. There is a tool to change this stuff after installation too. More settings here. You can set a custom screen resolution, but this won't work unless the video drivers are already included. Now we can press I to install. Since we set some custom options, but I don't want to use a different product key, I'll press P. Otherwise, to use the default options, you can press Y. This CD can also set up a workaround if you have more than 1 GB of RAM installed, but this computer doesn't, so it's not relevant. And there's even an option to install with 98 Lite, which lets you use the Windows Explorer shell from Windows 95, which doesn't have Internet Explorer and Active Desktop and stuff like that. But today, let's install the normal Windows 98. Now it's going to copy the installation files to the hard drive. And then some additional updates. And some driver packs. Unfortunately, it deletes those after installation. It would be nice to keep them in case you need them again, but if you do, you have to reinsert the CD and re-extract the driver packs manually. And then, because this is an unattended disk, the rest of the installation goes on its own. Here it is installing UDates. At one point it asks to restart, but it automatically clicks no for you, because it will restart later. And here we are at the desktop, but we're not done. It still has to install some updates, so let's let it do that. A little issue I found is that at this stage, if you click away from the command prompt, the mouse and keyboard completely freeze. The rest of the OS is not frozen. If you press the power button quickly, it will respond. But if there's still a command window open, it will tell you you have to exit the program manually. But with unresponsive keyboard and mouse, the only option is to hold down the power button to force the power off. I'm using a PS2 keyboard and mouse, by the way. I don't even want to think how USB peripherals would behave in a setup like this. And here is a quirk whose fault is not the OS, but the hardware. For some reason on this computer, the integrated graphics conflicts with other devices. You have to manually change the memory ranges to values which don't conflict with other devices. I just turn the values down until it says no devices are conflicting. And the last one can't be edited, but it's okay. So it gives a little warning here, but we can continue and restart once again. And it still doesn't have the video driver installed, we'll take care of that later. But at least it doesn't conflict. Now it's going to continue with more updates. And DirectX. Okay, now we're in the home stretch. And finally, there's the post setup applications. Those are additional programs that come as a bonus on the CD. But I don't want to install them now, so I'll press Q and then any key. And now the mouse and keyboard are frozen. But because the MS-DOS prompt window is closed, I can press the power button and it will shut down gracefully. And then start it back up. Now we can go to the system properties. For some reason it doesn't show the CPU here. But if you're curious, it's a single core Celeron D. Anyway, I prepared this other hard drive partition, which has the drivers for this computer. We'll start with the chipset drivers. And now after the chipset drivers are installed, Windows has a lot more hardware to detect. Now let's install the sound drivers and the graphics drivers. This is basic Intel integrated graphics, but Intel calls it extreme graphics. That sounds fancy. I guess it was okay at the time. And I don't have to install the network drivers because they're already included in this 10th anniversary edition disk. So let's see if sound and video work. Uh-oh, it asks to insert the disk for the Intel video drivers. But I think the temporary files that were extracted are gone now, so I can't help but click cancel. Some version conflict, but we'll keep the existing file. There are still some errors in Device Manager. I'm not sure why this is considered disabled. There's no setting for it in the BIOS, as far as I know. And for some reason, it installed a VMware driver for the mouse. So let's revert it to the standard PS2 mouse driver, because in case you couldn't tell, this is not a virtual machine. It also seems to have some issue with the USB controller, but looking at the manufacturer name, Old World Computing, this may be the wrong driver. And another driver with resource conflict, so let's edit that. And after fixing that conflict, it detects the name of the monitor. Even though it's obviously nothing to do with the USB, it's plugged into the integrated VGA on the motherboard. But let's not complain. We can turn up the resolution and the color depth. But for this video, I'll keep it at a lower resolution so it's easier to read. Here's the Intel Extreme Graphics 2 control panel. And here are the programs included in this version. Some extra stuff, but nothing major. I noticed that the video shifted over to the left a little bit, so I'll press the auto button on the monitor to auto adjust. And one thing you may have noticed is that it doesn't have the Windows 98 graphical splash screen. So let's enable it. You go to Folder Options, Show Hidden Files, find msdos.sys, uncheck the available attributes, open it with Notepad, and delete or comment the line logo equals zero, which disables the graphical startup. After that, you're supposed to re-enable the attributes, but I forgot. And here it is. I'm not very nostalgic for Windows 98 because I used Windows 95 and then skipped straight to XP, but 98 is not too different from 95. Anyway, now I'm re-enabling those attributes. Here are some of the updated programs. It comes with Internet Explorer 6 and Windows Media Player 9, both the newest versions that work on Windows 98. I'm not going to connect this to the internet right now, but it does work via Ethernet. Just set up a connection to the local area network. And here are the Windows Media Player skins. It seems to have all the Windows 98 background pictures, but it doesn't have the screensavers. So let's go to Control Panel, where we can see some additional things like Java and Tweak UI. And look at all the installed programs here, obviously unofficial. Here in Windows Setup, we can add some of the components that are missing. and you don't have to reinsert the Windows CD because it copied the installation files to the hard drive. Okay, something crashed here. I'm not sure why. So I'll press Ctrl-Alt-Delete and shut down and restart. Okay, we didn't really need internet connection sharing, did we? Shouldn't have checked it while installing those components. And here we have it. And by the way, now that the post setup installation phase is done, opening the command prompt and closing it, or switching away from it, doesn't freeze the mouse and keyboard anymore. Or maybe it was because I switched to the correct PS2 mouse driver. Anyway, here's the apps menu, the thing I skipped earlier, and you can see all the apps and tweaks that are included on this CD. Revolutions Pack 7 is something that modifies the system quite a bit, and so it recommends installing that separately. It even comes with ESET NOT32 antivirus, Outpost Firewall, and SpyBot Search and Destroy anti-spyware. But I'm pretty sure they can't be updated anymore. It asks to reboot, but I haven't installed anything, so I can say no. And there we have it. So would I recommend using this unofficial version instead of a normal Windows 98 disk? Absolutely not. And it's only for one reason. Hear the startup sound. If you don't expect it, it is scary. And it doesn't seem like the original Microsoft sound is anywhere in here. So you'd have to take it from an official disk. Some post-install programs may be a little useful, even on Windows XP, but some of them are too outdated. But then again, so is the OS, so swings and roundabouts. And that's it for now. I'm still messing with the Soptiplex, which seems a little more friendly with older operating systems compared to my IBM IntelliStation. It usually feels weird to install an older OS on a computer designed for something newer. But this hardware is a little too old for modern tasks, so it's not that wasteful to have some fun with it this way. Thank you for watching.